Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, and to those of you who are viewing via live streaming, my name is Fred McClure. I'm Chief Executive Officer of the George Bush Presidential Library Foundation. And on behalf of President and Mrs. George Bush, welcome to the George Bush Presidential Library Center here on the campus of Texas A&M University. Though we have many special guests attending this evening, our most special guests in the audience are a couple that recently celebrated their 71st wedding anniversary. Ladies and gentlemen, the 41st President of the United States and his First Lady. Along with Ambassador Ryan Crocker, Dean of the Bush School of Government and Public Service, who could not be with us tonight, my other colleague here at the Bush Center is the Director of the Bush Library and Museum, Mr. Warren Finch. Warren? Because many of you in our audience who are members of the Foundation, we are able to provide program and financial support to the George Bush Library and Museum and the Bush School of Government and Public Service. Your generosity allows us to sponsor programs that bring speakers to the center who possess unique insights into governing and also into public service. Tonight's speaker served as senior advisor to the 43rd President of the United States, George W. Bush, from 2000 to 2007. During his last 3 years, he was Deputy Chief of Staff to the President, coordinating White House policy making process. Before becoming known as the architect of President Bush's 2000 and 2004 campaigns, he was president of Karl, Rove & Company, an Austin-based public affairs firm that worked for Republican candidates, nonpartisan causes, and nonprofit groups. In politics, his clients included more than 75 Republican U.S. Senate, congressional, and gubernatorial campaigns in 24 states, as well as the moderate party of Sweden. Upon leaving the White House, Karl became a Fox News contributor, writes a weekly column for the Wall Street Journal. He also authored the New York Times bestseller, Courage and Consequence, My Life as a Conservative in the Fight. A native of Colorado, he attended the University of Utah, the University of Maryland, at College Park, George Mason University, and the University of Texas at Austin. A member of the Board of Trustees for the Texas Parks and Wildlife Foundation and the Texas State History Museum Foundation, he was inducted into the American Association of Political Consultants Hall of Fame in 2012. Please welcome the author of The Triumph of William McKinley, Why the Election of 1896 Still Matters, Karl Rove.
Thank you, Fred. You read it exactly as I wrote it, and I deeply appreciate that. Thank you for your kind introduction. Before I talk about this book available at Amazon.com for $23.50, I want to say a special word about two very important people. 41 years ago last October, I went to work for a man, tall, lanky Texan, chairman of the Republican National Committee. And ever since then, my life seems to have been revolving around people named Bush. There's rarely a day that goes by that I don't think about a lesson about life and character that I learned from a man who was the greatest man I've ever known, except my father. And as for Mrs. Bush, I still live in mortal fear of getting on her bad side. Anyway, enough of that. Let's get in the Wayback Machine and go back to 1896. At 5 points in American history, political scientists believe that there was a moment of realignment where the American political system was one way in the years leading up to that moment and distinctly different in the years leading after that. And what's ironic is we talk about four of those great moments by talking about the president whose election and subsequent administration helped bring about that change. 1800 with Thomas Jefferson and the end of the Federalist era. 1828 in the emergence of the modern party system under Andrew Jackson, 1860 in the emergence of the Republicans under Abraham Lincoln, 1932 in FDR's New Deal. But 1896, the other great pivotal moment in American politics, we talk more about the guy who lost the election, William Jennings Bryan, who has a parkway named after him in this community, and the guy who follows, Theodore Roosevelt. We don't talk about William McKinley, the 25th President of the United States, who takes a broken political system, fixes it, and ushers in a 36-year period of Republican dominance. The landscape that he saw as the 1896 election approached is over 100 years distance from us, but it's awfully familiar in many ways. The American political system was broken. In the five presidential elections leading into the 1896 presidential contest, no one won 50% of the vote. The two political parties were so evenly matched against each other that nobody could get a majority. They all won by plurality. Two of those elections, somebody won the Electoral College and lost the popular vote. And one of those contests involved a five-month-long dispute about the outcome in Florida. One president was elected with a majority in the Electoral College and a plurality in the popular vote nationwide of 7,000 votes. We had divided government for most of this period of time. We had 2 years during this period in which there was a Republican president, Republican Senate, and a Republican House, and 2 years in which there was a Democrat president, a Democrat House, and a Democrat Senate. And the other 20 years, we had divided government, where the parties had deeply imbued views about what the course of the country should be that were deeply in conflict with each other. The Republicans were the party of a robust, more robust federal government and high taxes through high tariffs and protections for the voting rights of black and white Republicans in the South. The Democratic Party was the party of states' rights, limited national government, low taxes through low tariffs, and a blind eye to the efforts in the South to wipe out the voting rights of black and white Republicans. And not only did they have different views of what the future of America ought to be, they were still fighting the Civil War. They were not only simply disagreeing with each other over which course the country should take, they were still fighting the outcome of North versus South, a conflict in which 600,000 Americans were killed. In fact, when the Democrats take control of the House of Representatives in 1874, for the first time in almost 20 years, it's called the Victory of the Brigadiers because so many Confederate officers are elected to the U.S. House of Representatives. These were men who fought each other, who knew that on the other side of the aisle in the House of Representatives and the Senate were men who had been on the other side of the battle line during 4 years of an awful conflict. And there was political gridlock. Political gridlock that makes today in Washington look like everybody sitting around the campfire singing Kumbaya and roasting marshmallows together. Because of this ugliness, I was reading and doing the research for the book. I'm reading about a particular debate in which the Republicans are in the minority in the House, and yet they kill a free trade measure sponsored by Roger Q. Mills, the Texas Democrat chairman of the Ways and Means Committee. And I'm reading through the congressional record, and it says one Democrat gets up to excoriate 40 Democrats have defected from the free trade views of the Democratic Party and stood with the Republicans to kill this free trade measure. And one of the Democrats is incredibly outraged by this and stands up to excoriate the former Speaker of the House, Democrat Samuel Randall of Pennsylvania, and his 40 thieves, he calls them, the 40 Democrats who defect on this measure and kill this free trade bill. And he says, he turns to one of them in particular and says, "I would not blank you if you were a dog." Now, it's in the congressional record blanked out, but use your imagination. And the partisanship is unbelievable. If you lose the House of Representatives, your party loses control of the House, and you won re-election by a narrow margin, you're kicked out of the House. And this is routine. The Democrats do it to the Republicans, and the Republicans do it to the Democrats. And it happens every time power changes in the House. And the gridlock is amazing. 1890, the Republicans take control of the House. Back then, they were civilized, so they didn't meet until the fall of 1891. They didn't make them meet during the summer and spring and summer in Washington. They came in the fall of 1891, and the Democrats announced they will not allow a single bill to be brought up on the floor of the House. They'll refuse to answer the roll call. The Speaker of the House, Thomas Brackett Reed of Maine, tolerates this for a couple of days of fruitless calls for roll calls, which show no quorum. And about to the second or third day, he turns to the clerk and says, the chair directs the clerk to show Mr. Jones present, Mr. Smith present, calls out every Democrat on the floor of the House. One of them stands up and angrily says, under God and the Constitution, you have no right to call me present on the floor of the House without my permission. And the speaker says, the chair is merely stating a fact. Does the honorable gentleman from Kentucky deny he's present on the floor? This kicks off a three-month-long battle over whether or not the speaker, now called Czar Reed, has the authority to do this, that is ultimately settled in the U.S. Supreme Court. And in the meantime, not a single bill gets taken up on the floor of the House. One Texan provides a pivotal role. Howdy Martin, William Henry Howdy Martin of East Texas, Athens, Texas, 6'6" tall, thin as a rail, mean as a snake, fought the entire Civil War as an officer in Hood's brigade, and he shows up in the opening moments of the debate and angrily points to Reed on the podium and says, if any member will order me to remove this dictator from his position upon the podium, I will do so by force forthwith. Reed says, the honorable gentleman from Texas is out of order and moves on. Martin is so irritated, he takes to showing up every day on the floor, taking a seat right in front of the speaker's podium, pulling out his 16-inch long Bowie knife and methodically sharpening it on his boot sole in order to menace the Speaker of the House. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but I do not remember Nancy Pelosi doing this in 2011. We also have an economy that is causing a great many Americans to have a degree of anxiety about their position in the world. First of all, we're in the midst of a Great Depression as the 1896 election approaches. The worst depression the country has experienced in its history or will experience until the Great Depression of the 1930s. But even more than that, the economy is changing in ways that are almost difficult for us today to comprehend and understand. We're going through a period of great innovation. Think about a period in which they create the electric light bulb and electric engines and the automobile and refrigerated rail cars and tie the country together through a national rail system and telegraph and create machines that make things that artisans used to have to create by hand that are now made with mechanical precision at a speed that no artisan can keep up with. And people are suddenly saying, is there a place for me in this economy? A farmer goes from being worried about creating enough to feed his family and have a little bit to sell at the end of the season to now worrying about what's going to happen with the cotton crop in Egypt or what are the wheat prices going to be affected by the crop in the Ukraine, living in a global international market. And as a result, we see the first burst of populism in America. And a lot of it started right here in Texas. We also had a great deal of anxiety about America that was changing in front of everybody's eyes. People were saying, is this the America that we grew up in? We'd always been a nation of immigrants. But starting in the 1870s, the immigration started coming from new places, not the familiar places, not England and Scotland and Wales and Germany and Ireland. Now suddenly immigration was more coming from weird places with weird people who didn't sound and look like the white Anglo-Saxon, mostly Protestants that had come to America. There were Ukrainian wheat farmers and Bohemian beer makers and Croatian miners and Spanish tanners and Italian potters and Greek fishermen. And suddenly America was this frothy collection of immigrants who didn't look and sound like the America that people had seen for over two centuries. And the anxiety about this change in America was felt deeply throughout the country. And along comes this election with a broken political system, an economy that is in disarray, and an America with cultural challenge facing us. And we have two unusual candidates emerge. The Republicans have a battle. The battle is between the machine bosses. The Republicans, bad guys, are led by the Thomas Collier Platt, the former senator from New York. He's called the easy boss. His main assistant is probably the greatest political mind of the 19th century, Matthew S. Quay, Republican senator from Pennsylvania. They call themselves the Combine, the Republican bosses, and they write each other coded letters. Their chief operative is the publisher of the Des Moines Register, James S. Rhett Clarkson. I keep seeing this name Rhett, and I kept trying to figure out, what's that nickname? Turned out he had atrocious handwriting. So whenever he would send editorials down to be set in type at the Des Moines Register, he would write at the top, Rhett, R-E-T, Clarkson, so he could make certain they returned the editorial and interpreted his lousy handwriting correctly. And he writes coded letters. I found one to Thomas Collier Platt. I need a pyramid this week and a pagoda next week, he said. I stumbled across the letter in the papers at Yale of Platt, and he had gotten so many code words in this particular letter that he had handwritten in pencil above each code word what it meant. I need $3,000 this week, and I need $5,000 next. Politics doesn't change. And the front runner is backed by the combine men. It's Reid, the acerbic Speaker of the House, the man who has returned the Republicans to power in the House and passed through an enormous, complicated piece of legislative package in 1891 and 1892, and then is now again Speaker in 1895, and he's the front runner. But we got another guy running, and it's a guy you know nothing about. You may think you know something about William McKinley, the 25th President of the United States, but he is one of the most remarkable men ever to seek the office, and nobody knows who this guy is. He's completely self-made. And not only that, but he is an unbelievably courageous war hero. He enters the war at the age of 18, much like President Bush 41 entered the war at the age of 18. And he ends the war 4 years later, not as the private that he entered the war, but as a major, having received three battlefield commissions for unbelievable valor. Two of them involve suicide missions. The second of the suicide missions happens when he's a second lieutenant. The Army of the Kanawha is fighting in the Shenandoah Valley. And his brigade commander is in charge of the five regiments who make up the front line just south of Winchester. And early in the morning, Jubal Early's troops break out of the left of the Union and begin to crush the Union front line. And the brigade commander orders a retreat of the five regiments under his stewardship. Only one of them, at the extreme right of the Union line, the 13th West Virginia, doesn't get the order. They're in an orchard. And they're sheltered from the fight, and they don't understand they're about ready to be cut off and slaughtered by the advancing Confederates. So the brigade commander looks around and finds Second Lieutenant William McKinley and orders him to ride across the battlefield. As the Union line retreats, McKinley is to ride across the battlefield in front of the lines to reach the 13th West Virginia on an open battlefield with advancing Confederates and cannon and musket fire all around him and order the 13th West Virginia to retire. His tent mate, Russell Hastings, later a general, said it was a suicide mission. And McKinley gets on his horse and rides across an open battlefield where all hell is breaking loose. And at one point, a shell goes off right next to him. And Hastings says, we thought he was gone. But out of the gray cloud came the small brown horse with the erect horseman. McKinley makes it to the 13th West Virginia in the nick of time and gets them out of there just before they're cut to pieces. He rides behind the front lines and returns to the brigade commander's tent and walks in. And his brigade commander, Colonel Rutherford B. Hayes, turns around and sees him and, startled, says, my God, I never expected to see you in life again. He is later recommended for the Congressional Medal of Honor for his heroism and discourages the application from being pursued, saying, I was only doing my duty. And he's a remarkable legislative leader and becomes the leading voice of the Republican Party on economic issues as the 1896 election approaches. On the other side, the Democratic contest is one of the wildest you've ever seen because it does not involve a single candidate. The Democrats decide that their battle is going to be over the platform. The Silvermen hate the gold policies of the incumbent Democratic president, Grover Cleveland, so they say to themselves, let's not advance candidates, let's advance an idea, free silver. And when we do so, and we win the majority necessary to write the platform, then we'll agree upon a candidate. So even though the Democrats have a front runner, his name is Richard Park Bland of Missouri. For 20 years, he has led the fight in the House of Representatives for the free and unlimited coinage of silver. As a result, his nickname is Silver Dick. When I first read it in the New York Times, I said it must have meant something different back then. But the Democrats have a primary contest in which the entire emphasis is on repudiating the sitting Democratic president, electing enough delegates who are committed to go to the National Convention to rewrite the platform, and then when they get the majority to influence the selection of the nominee, and they agree among themselves, the bimetallic men, the silver Democrats, agree they will do this, and they set off to do it and succeed in electing nearly two-thirds of the delegates to the Democratic National Convention committed to the idea of free silver and to repudiating the sitting Democratic president. And they do so with a viciousness that you cannot believe. In one of the last conventions in Indiana, the pastor gets up to give the invocation and asks for God's blessing on all our elected officials, including President Cleveland, and a delegate immediately stands up and calls upon him to withdraw his call for a celestial blessing upon Cleveland because he is the Benedict Arnold of the Democratic Party and the Judas Iscariot of the country. I mean, he immediately withdrew his blessing on the president. And as a result, the Democrats arrive at their convention with the front runner, Silver Dick Bland, and Uncle Horace Boys. We need to bring back this habit of nicknames. It's just fantastic. And the Horace Boys, the Democrat governor, former Republican turned Democrat governor of Iowa, and a couple of others. But among them is not one name. Nobody considers William Jennings Bryan a potential serious candidate for president. 36 hours before he is nominated, the publisher of the Rocky Mountain News visits him and says to him, "You're the leader of the Silver Democrats from Nebraska. We want you to support this particular man for president." And he says, No, we're not going to do that." And to make conversation, Patterson says to Bryan, "Well, who's going to be the nominee?" And Bryan says, "I've got as good a chance as anybody. I've got the Nebraska delegation on the first ballot, and I've been promised half of the Oklahoma Territory on the second." Literally nobody, very few people know who this guy is. And yet he ends up giving a speech that in 30 minutes stampedes the Democratic convention and a day later is named the nominee. But that speech itself is the result of 7 accidents that occur in the days leading up to it. And if any one of these 7 moments had gone a different direction, William Jennings Bryan would not have been in the moment, not have been able to give the speech, not be able to stampede the convention, and not be the Democratic nominee. And when he becomes a Democratic nominee, he frees the Democrats of responsibility for the Depression and puts them comfortably in the lead for the general election. Now, this election's outcome is not foreordained. There's no guarantee that either side is going to win this. This election is not the result of anonymous forces working their way through the campaign and working their way through the election. It is the result of men making decisions, some of which are right and some of which are wrong. And they're really interesting characters. And the outcome is one in which somehow or another, McKinley finds a way to talk about the greatest issue of the campaign, the currency. An issue that we find it hard to understand today, he found a way to talk about it in a way that attracted the support of working class Americans, of laborers and miners and factory workers. And look, we don't get the gold issue versus silver. We don't. But it really had at the heart of it a pretty easy concept. And Bryan himself encapsulated that concept. "This is what is at the heart of the battle over gold versus silver," he said. And he said it in 3 sentences, and I'm going to read you from his Cross of Gold speech. And tell me if they have a familiar ring. "There are 2 ideas of government," Bryan said. "Republicans believe if you, quote, if you just legislate to make the well-to-do prosperous, then their prosperity will leak through on those below them. Democrats believe, quote, if you legislate to make the masses prosperous, then their prosperity will find its way up and through every class that rests upon it." And at the heart of the 1896 election is this battle over an idea that we're still fighting over today. And McKinley's genius was to eventually figure out that, A, he needed to talk about this issue that he didn't want to talk about. He wanted to avoid it. 2, to take the strength of his opponent, his support for free silver, and turn it into a weakness by finding a way to talk about it in a way that won the votes of working class Americans. And he did so. He did so with the help of 2 men. One is the former president of the American Federation of Labor, the largest labor union in America, and the other one is a failed New York politician who's a complete weasel. A young kid who had run 3rd in the race for the mayorship of New York City and then had been rescued from oblivion by being appointed to a city job, but knew that he had no upward mobility in the state of New York because he was on the wrong side of Thomas Collier Platt. So like any ambitious young guy, he says, "I'm going to throw in with the guy that I think might be president, Thomas Brackett Reed." He writes influential articles on his behalf and campaigns actively for him in the primary and loses. Shortly after McKinley is nominated, he writes his sister a letter saying, "We had a good platform, and, quote, McKinley is a good man, but he is weak, and I worry about him in a moment of crisis for our country." A few days later, he writes one of McKinley's closest personal friends and says, "We must do everything we can to elect McKinley. And when he is elected, you must be the Secretary of the Treasury or at least the Minister of France. And my ambitions, such as they are, can go by the wayside." And spends the next 5 months weaseling his way into the campaign. I put his letters in here in his comments. I put his importations to McKinley's friends to help him out. I put in here his speeches. He's invited by a United States senator, a buddy of his, to go on a speaking tour in one of the five battleground states of the election, New York. And he campaigns with him throughout upstate New York. And the United States senator makes dignified speeches contrasting the two parties' platforms. And this kid gets up and excoriates William Jennings Bryan in the most vicious language you can imagine. And as a result, gets every headline and every story for 5 days straight in the New York newspapers as he takes the bark and peels it off of William Jennings Bryan. At the end of it, his friend John Hay, Abraham Lincoln's personal secretary, writes Henry Adams, another one of our mutual friends, and said, "H and T have gone to Canton to bare their tummies to McKinley and to before the major and commit Harry Carey. McKinley invited me over to watch the spectacle, but I didn't want to join the mob trampling his lawn." Well, this makes his speeches in upstate New York have made such an impression that somebody in the McKinley campaign says, "Okay, here's the deal. Go to Chicago and give a speech. Attack Bryan in front of 23,000 college students at the American College Republican League convention, and then trail Bryan through Michigan and do just what you did in New York. Take the bark off of him." And he does so with three speeches. The first one is called The Age of the Demagogue. It's a two-hour-long speech given in Chicago that starts out with him saying, "It is not merely schoolgirls who have hysterics. Demagogues are hysterical, too." And I traced the three speeches that he gives. I discovered a previously unknown version of the speech that he delivered in Jackson, Michigan, where he drops the stuff that doesn't work in Chicago and tunes it up. And by Saturday morning, he gives this speech. It is retitled the Jack Cade Speech. It's down to an hour and a half, and it is one beautiful, mean, vicious piece of work. And that afternoon, Bryan reads it in the afternoon Detroit newspapers and is so infuriated, spends his entire speech that night responding to the charges raised by the young New York failed politician. Mission accomplished. At the end of the campaign, their mutual friends, the friends of this young man and McKinley, go to McKinley and say, "Look, the young man did you some good work. He did you some, gave you some good advice, and he did some good labor on your behalf. And he wants a job in your administration, doesn't want to be in the cabinet, wants to be in a new job that has never been held by anybody before, newly created. And he'd do a good job in it. He's just the kind of young man that you want to encourage and raise up in the Republican Party, a reform-minded individual like you. Give him a chance." And McKinley says, "Okay, I will. But, quote, I do not trust your young man Roosevelt. He's too pugnacious." Theodore Roosevelt's entire future depends upon being a weasel in the 1896 campaign. And believe me, after you finish reading this book, even if you're a fan of Roosevelt like me, he was a weasel in this campaign. And everybody shows up in the first modern presidential campaign. Everybody shows up in the first real presidential campaign conducted like we think campaigns are run today. The McKinley campaign goes out and organizes everybody. They print 250 million pieces of literature in 14 different languages, and organize a group for every one of those. They organize young men in a new thing. There's a fad sweeping the country that every young man wants to be part of, and so they organize a group of these young men. They call them the wheelmen, bicycle riders. In fact, they have a huge parade in Canton, Ohio, where literally thousands of Republican young men bring their bicycles to Canton to show off in front of the major, including a band that plays its instruments while riding up the street by riding up North Market Street in front of the major. And this is a modern presidential campaign like we think about them today, and it's run by not Mark Hanna, but by a 30-year-old kid you've never heard of, who McKinley sees. He's the son McKinley never has. But everybody shows up in this campaign. Everybody. One of my favorite minor characters is a Democrat, Burke Cochran. He's a Tammany Hall Democrat. He's not a particularly impressive-looking guy. I put a picture of him in the book. But he was born in Ireland, and he apparently had a spectacular baritone. And when he spoke, men wanted to be his friend, and women wanted to be his lover. And he was in Congress and then lost and was a successful New York lawyer. And in 1894, he takes a lover, a British aristocratic widow, and he spends most of the next several years in her arms in Paris. He becomes quite close to her 19-year-old son, who comes and spends a month with him in October of 1895 as a young lad is on the route to Cuba to become a war correspondent. In April of 1896, Cochrane breaks his leg, and he goes to recuperate in the arms of his lover in Paris. But by August, something has happened, and they break off their two-year-long affair, and he returns to the United States. When he's approaching New York, he sends word to the press to meet him dockside, and they do. Interested to hear what he has to say, and he says the following. He says, "I'm a Democrat. I always have been a Democrat, and I always will be a Democrat. But I cannot support the silver platform of Chicago or the silver Democratic candidate of Chicago," meaning William Jennings Bryan. "So therefore, at my own expense, under the auspices of the Honest Money League, I will tour the country urging like-minded Democrats to support William McKinley for president." Now, this is not done in this era. This is simply not done. This is like 1972, John Connally saying, "Well, I was Lyndon's fair-haired boy, but I can't stomach McGovern. I'm for Nixon." And as a result, there's a tremendous desire to hear from Burke Cochran. Bryan gives a speech in New York in a couple of days, and the Honest Money Democrats and Republicans call on Cochran to respond in Madison Square Garden a week after Bryan, and he does so with a spectacular speech. I found a transcript of it in which they have interpolations of the crowd stands and cheers, cries of "hit him again, hit him again." And, you can just hear the crowd responding to this brilliant speech, 1.5 hour long, without a single note. At the end of it, the Honest Money men say the election is over. The Easy Boss says, "We have won." They've got three more months of hard fight, but it's a spectacular speech and the start of a nationwide tour by Burke Cochran. And the speech is reprinted in every newspaper around the country, every Republican newspaper. It's reprinted in London, where the son of his former lover reads it. And it's taken with the incredible speech that his mother's friend has given, and immediately wires him and says, "It was a magnificent address. I hope it will have a huge moral effect. Devotedly yours, Winston Spencer Churchill." 1947, Churchill delivers the Iron Curtain speech in Westminster, Missouri, and afterwards an American admirer writes him a letter and says, "You are the greatest orator of our century." And he writes him back, "No, I'm not. Everything that I learned about the use of the English language, how to hold thousands in thrall, I learned at the feet of my mentor, Burke Cochran." Everybody shows up. Anyway, it's not a dry tomb. It's got sex, violence, backstabbing, betrayal, courage, ambition, and really cool nicknames. I hope you enjoy the tale. Thank you. I mentioned it's available.
Thank you. Thank you.
So let's talk about the man behind the scenes. This guy, Mark Hanna, he had a $3.5 million budget, big budget for a presidential nationwide campaign. Was he really controlling McKinley?
Yeah, the historians sort of say he was. But one of the controversial things about this book is that, look, Mark Hanna is an admirable guy. But he is not the brains behind McKinley. What happened is William Randolph Hearst understood the admirable character of McKinley, so he told his writers and cartoonists, "Don't attack McKinley." McKinley, war hero, devoted husband of an invalid wife, a man of enormous character and integrity. So don't go after him. Go after Hanna. But Hanna, as smart as he was, if you look at the major decisions in the fall campaign, he's wrong. He says McKinley's got to go out on the road. McKinley said, "Nah, we're going to run the front porch campaign." He says, "You know what? You don't need to take on silver." McKinley says, "You know what? Reluctantly, I got to take on silver." Think of Mark Hanna more like Don Evans or Bob Mosbacher, the devoted friend of the presidential candidate who wants more than anything in life to see him made the president. But don't expect the guy who's the smart guy behind the presidential campaign is McKinley himself. And one of McKinley's great talents is that McKinley spots talent. In early 1894, a young kid shows up, grew up in Ohio, got his law degree in Cincinnati. After getting his law degree, he lights out for the West. He's a frontier lawyer in Lincoln, Nebraska. He's 28 years old when McKinley meets him. Red hair, about 6 foot tall, which is tall for that age, combs his hair right in the middle, and parts it right in the middle, and he smokes a corncob pipe where he absentmindedly, the corncob is sideways, so he's always covered with burning ash. The kid practices law in a small office building in Lincoln, Nebraska, with another young lawyer. The two men, this guy, the other guy is 5 years his senior. They're members of a men's debate club, and they debate each other. And they also practice law in the same building, William Jennings Bryan. And the two men often have lunch with a third pal, who is the ROTC instructor at the University of Nebraska, a West Pointer named John J. Pershing. So this guy shows up in Columbus and says, McKinley, you're a modernizer. You want to reform the Republican Party, and I agree with you. And if you run for president, I want to help you. And then McKinley sees him again in October of 1894 when McKinley's barnstorming the country in the midterms. And the kid says, I got Nebraska organized for you. I got some friends that I've made contact with in Wyoming, and we're working on the Dakotas. And here's everybody you need to be in touch with, these guys. And McKinley says, this is a smart kid. So he then picks the kid. The kid says, you know what, though? I'm leaving Lincoln. I put together a little money from some banking deals and real estate, and I want to go to Chicago and become an entrepreneur. I want to buy gas utilities, which then served a very small area. And his idea was, I'll buy several small utilities, knit them together, get economies of scale, and I'll make a bunch of money. And so he moves to Illinois in January 1895. Now, Illinois is the key contest in the Republican presidential primary battle. New York is in the hands of the Combine under Boss Platt. Pennsylvania, the second largest delegation, firmly under the control of Matthew S. Quay. Ohio, loosely under the control of McKinley, third largest delegation. And then we got the fourth largest delegation, which is Illinois. And Illinois is under the control of a really interesting character, William J. Larmer, the blonde boss. At the age of 22, he shows up to vote for James G. Blaine and is so disgusted with the quality of the Republican organization in the Second Ward of Chicago that he turns around and organizes other young men. He's a streetcar conductor, organizes young men, and 2 years later has turned the Second Ward from a Democrat stronghold into a Republican stronghold and is awarded a seat on the Cook County Republican Central Committee. 2 years later, he is given a job as one of 1,300 people in the water department. 2 years after that, at the age of 28, he's in charge of the water department with 1,300 patronage employees under his command. And surprise, surprise, 2 years after that, he becomes the Cook County Republican chairman with 10,000 patronage workers and gets himself elected to Congress. And at the age of 34 in 1896, he's thinking, I want to go to the Senate sometime, and the best way for me to do this is to throw in with the Combine and get them to give me money and prestige and power that will cement my role. And so what does McKinley do? He says, I'm going to take the kid who's just moved to Chicago and put him in charge of my campaign. And the kid is a kid. He's 30 years old now. And he has one other young guy working for him who's a streetcar conductor as well, and two older gentlemen who are Civil War generals, 30 years his superior. But they are so taken with this young man's command and strength that they start calling him the general. And he has a card file in which he keeps tracks of every delegate to every county convention in Illinois and says to these three guys who are working for him, go here, go there, we need more support in this county, and go talk to this guy here. And he is masterful. And he wins the Illinois convention in a total, complete upset. And it ends the Republican presidential nomination battle because it is so surprising and so unexpected. And I discovered this guy when I'm going through the McKinley papers, and I find a beautiful handwritten note, Mr. President. The night of the Illinois victory, McKinley writes the young man. And I knew nothing about this young man. It's the first time I stumbled across him. I cannot close the day without sending you a message of appreciation and congratulations. There is nothing in all of this long campaign so signal and significant as the triumph at Springfield. I cannot find words to express my admiration for your high qualities of leadership. You have won exceptional honor. You had long ago won my heart.
He's a son McKinley never has. He goes to Washington with McKinley, and at the age of 32 is in charge of the nation's banking system. He becomes a successful Chicago banker and entrepreneur, the first director of the first Bureau of the Budget under Warren G. Harding, vice president under Calvin Coolidge, ambassador to Great Britain, first head of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, and the fourth American to win the Nobel Peace Prize. But in 1894, Charles G. Dawes is a 28-year-old punk, and McKinley says the kid's got what it takes. And that's the guy who is the campaign manager for McKinley in the fall of 1896, not Mark Hanna. And it is a remarkable story of McKinley's keen judgment of people, but also the incredible talents of this young man who writes memos. These memos that he writes back and forth to Hanna and McKinley are just fun to read, because you could see some young kid with all the stresses and strains of a political campaign dealing with it, and he is one of the most meticulous guys. He keeps track of the budget to the penny. He accounts for every one of the $3.5 million that is spent. He accounts for it down to the penny. And there's one funny letter he writes McKinley's cousin, William McKinley Osborne, and says, all the crooks showed up expecting to get their sweetheart deals, but we're competitively bidding every job of printing that we have in this place. And it's fun to read.
And you also mentioned that McKinley was the first presidential candidate to reach out to blacks. 1896 was also the year Plessy versus Ferguson, where the court said that racial segregation in public facilities was cool. There were, 11% perhaps of the population of the U.S. then, 90% of these guys in the South. How did McKinley do this from his front porch campaign in terms of his outreach?
Well, first of all, this was really important to McKinley. He was an abolitionist before the war. His parents were both Quakers, of Quaker descent, and both of them abolitionists. And for him, the Civil War, almost from the start, was a battle about slavery. In fact, when the war ends, the fall of 1865, he's involved in his first two political activities. His old commander, the man who sent him on the suicide mission, Rutherford B. Hayes, is running for governor of Ohio, and he throws himself enthusiastically into his old commander's campaign. And the other cause is a constitutional amendment to the Ohio Constitution guaranteeing black suffrage. And he is excited that Rutherford B. Hayes wins, but he is deeply depressed when Ohio voters turn down black suffrage guarantees 55-45. So this is a theme throughout his entire life. But what happens is in March of 1895, he goes south ostensibly for a vacation. The Palm Beach of the time was Thomasville, Georgia. And if you've ever been to Thomasville, you can see these beautiful old 1870s, 1880s, 1890s mansions that were owned by wealthy Midwesterners and wealthy Northeasterners as their winter places. There was literally an overnight train to New York. And he goes there because it's on two rail lines, one east-west and one north-south, and he invites all the Southern Republican leaders to come and visit with him then. Because normally what would happen is you would buy their support. These were mostly poor and black, and you would promise them patronage and give them money. But McKinley says, I don't want to do it that way. I want to win these men to my cause by assuring them of my friendship. And, you know, I want to look like a winner, and I want to be their friend. And what happens is on this trip, he goes to Jacksonville, Florida, after being in Thomasville and meeting a lot of these black Republican leaders. He goes to Jacksonville, Florida, and the white Republicans throw him a reception. And they say, oh, we're delighted to have you here, and we're going to support you. But don't get too close to the black end of the party. And the word gets out that he's been threatened like that. And so what happens is the black end of the party says, well, by God, we need to meet with McKinley to make certain he's not going to throw in with these rascals. And so the next morning, McKinley does something that has never been done in American politics, and that is, as a candidate seeking the nomination of his party, he meets openly with a group of black Republicans and asks for their vote. 40 men, led by a timber manager, timber farm manager, go to meet with him at the St. James Hotel in Jacksonville, Florida, and meet with him. And this is no Democrat and no Republican have ever done this before. And the next day, he does it even bigger. He goes to a church in Savannah, Georgia, and openly appears before an audience of several hundred black Republicans and asks for their support. It's the first time any presidential candidate of either party has done this. And this continues in the fall. I recently bought a badge. It's the Colored Republican Club of Morton, Pennsylvania. And it's this beautiful badge that they wore when they went to visit him in Canton, Ohio. It has the date of their visit. I know exactly what he said to them. And this club organized itself. And they were, and the clubs like this were constantly coming to visit with him. This badge is particularly poignant, however, because somebody wore this badge when they went to see him in 1896. And on the back of it is a black badge struck when he was assassinated in September of 1901 by the Morton Colored Republicans of Morton, Pennsylvania, to commemorate their fallen chief. And so somebody had sewn on the back. McKinley has won election the first time by 20,000 votes. In the fall of 1893, the APA calls him up on the telephone and says, "We've discovered that there are two Catholic prison guards at a prison outside of Cincinnati. You must fire them, and we're going to call you back Monday to hear your decision." And they call him back Monday, and he says, "Our Constitution says no religious test for holding office. The prison guards will hold their jobs." And they say, "Okay, fine, you're off our voter guide for this fall." They distributed a voter guide as to who was worthy of being voted for, and they said, "You're gone, you're off." And so he's nervous. But Hannah lets the word be known to the Catholic hierarchy, and they go out and compliment him on being an outstanding leader and, you know, make the speeches from the pulpit, and he's reelected with 60,000 votes. Well, this enrages the APA. So when he gets to running in 1896, in April of 1896, they declare that all of the Republican presidential candidates, Thomas Reed of Maine, Senator Davis of Minnesota, you know, Senator from Illinois, the Senator from Iowa, the Governor of Michigan, all of these people are acceptable, except William McKinley. And McKinley takes them on, and he beats them badly. I mean, he is adroit about it. He's thoughtful about it. But he says, "We're not going to stand for this kind of intolerance." And then he rubs their noses in it once he's beaten them. The opening invocation at the Republican Convention is not given by, as it has traditionally been given, by a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, generally a Methodist. Instead, the convention in St. Louis is opened by Rabbi Sale. And the second day of the convention, the invocation is offered by a pastor, a close friend of McKinley's, who's the pastor of an AME church in Cleveland, Ohio. And McKinley's message was, "Our party is going to be open to Catholics." And when he is endorsed in October by the Bishop of St. Paul, Minnesota, Bishop Ireland, writes a powerful letter. A couple of people, including the founder of the Pabst Blue Ribbon Empire, write the bishop a letter and say, "Where do you stand on this contest?" And he writes this open letter that is published by the Republicans that goes off like an atom bomb, because it says, if you're a Catholic, you can vote for McKinley. And the battle in the Midwest is being fought over a lot of farmers, many of whom are Catholic, who might be sort of, you know, like gold rather than silver, but McKinley's a Republican and they're Democrats, and this makes him the first Republican candidate ever endorsed by a member of the Catholic hierarchy, and means that for the next 30-some-odd years, most Catholics in America vote Republican, as do most Jews. 1896 campaign is the first campaign in which there's organized anti-Semitism, and it's done by the Democrats, so much so that at the end of the campaign, Brian has to go to Chicago and accept an award from Jewish Democrats, which is a Silver Star of David, and he gives a speech saying, "It is not merely the financial policy of the Rothschilds to which we are opposed. We're also opposed to the financial policies of J. Pierpont Morgan." But the damage was already done when at the Democratic Convention, literally people were walking up and down the streets of the Democratic Convention. Let's see here. There were discordant, this is on the opening day of the Democratic Convention. There were discordant notes and slurs of "down with the hook-nosed Shylocks of Wall Street" and "down with the Christ-killing gold bugs" were chanted by bigots in the streets of Chicago. And so for the next 30-some-odd years until Franklin Roosevelt, most Jews in America voted Republican.
Interesting. All right, let's take a few questions from the audience. Since I didn't read much more of the book.
At least he's honest about it. You did read more, but you're just trying to hide your knowledge. Yeah, there we go, my former colleague.
Are you sending us a message about the election?
The question was, am I sending a message about this year? And look, I didn't set out to write this about this year. The subtitle is The Publisher's Choice. I set out to write what I hope would be a durable history of an election that's important that doesn't get much attention. There have only been two books written about this election, one of them by Stanley Jones in 1964 and the other one by a wonderful professor at SMU who just died a month or so ago. But otherwise, this has not been much attention. And both of those are political science books. And I wanted to write the tale from inside the campaigns themselves. But the messages are they're important lessons for either party. The most important message was take on the big issues. McKinley doesn't want to talk about silver. He wants to talk about protection because he's uncomfortable talking about currency. But he has to do it. The second big message was you have to take on you have to take on your opponent's strength and turn it into weakness, which he does with the help of Roosevelt and the former president of the Knights of Labor, who help him find the right language to describe the currency issue in a way that will appeal to working class people. And third, you have to expand the electorate. You have to be involved in addition, not subtraction. He goes after Catholics. It's a scandal when all these weird people start showing up in Chicago, Canton. Who are these Greeks and Croatians and Ukrainians and weird people from weird places who don't, you know, go to the First Methodist Church? Who are these people? And McKinley's being deliberate about it. And then the language is unbelievably prescient. You read a William Jennings Bryan speech, and it could be Bernie Sanders easily. The Shylocks of Wall Street, the money grubbers of Lombard Street, the idle holders of capital, the money power, all of these kind of excoriations of Wall Street, we've heard them before. And McKinley, Bryan is like a madman at the end. I mean, by September and October, he's traveling around the country in this furious train trip around the country that's never been done before. He travels 18,000 miles by train. Many days he gets up, has to buy his own train ticket. He's sitting in a common car. He has to rush off and grab a sandwich at the depot when they're watering the train. And he's got to hope that at the end of the evening, somebody's got a hotel room where he's going to show up. It's not until October 7th that he's given his own private rail car. But his speeches are wild. Everybody shows up at these things to see. I mean, 3 to 5 million people show up at his rallies. Many of them are Republicans. And when he starts spotting gold ribbons or McKinley badges, he starts pointing to those people and excoriating them personally, belittling them, including women and children who show up to hear his speech. And McKinley is just the opposite. He's a unifier. He says capital and labor need to be together. Neither can be prosperous without the other being prosperous. We will only be a country that is prosperous if all are given a shot at prosperity. And he backs this up by, you know, reaching out to everybody he possibly can. In fact, one of the most amazing moments of the campaign, and again, it's hard for us to understand this given where we are today, but on October 9th, 1896, 44 train cars of people arrive in Canton, Ohio. And off those 44 train cars are 2,000 men dressed in gray uniforms and their families, 2,000 Confederate veterans of the Shenandoah Valley Campaign, organized by Reverend Abram Funkhauser of Harrisburg, Virginia. And they've come to pay their respects to McKinley. They're met by an honor guard from the Grand Army of the Republic, the Union War veterans. The wives of the GAR have made this beautiful silk banner. Every Confederate veteran is given a commemorative knife. With it engraved upon it is a favorite phrase of McKinley's drawn from Washington's farewell address. No east, no west, no north, no south, but a common country. They're given badges, 2,000 badges, half gray, half blue, the same phrase written upon the badge, a red, white, and blue rosette at the top, and a chromolith of McKinley and his running mate beneath. And they're given these badges. They're taken to the tabernacle where they're fed lunch while they wait for a missing train load of people who had gotten stuck by a washout to arrive. And then in the early afternoon, these 2,000 Confederate veterans plus Union veterans, led by bands and flags, form up in the courthouse square in Canton and march up North Market Street towards McKinley's home. And the streets are lined by tens of thousands of people. This is a small town, about 25,000 people. but tens of thousands of people have shown up to witness this moment, and they are singing patriotic songs and weeping, many of them openly, as a sight of blue and gray of national reconciliation. No president, no Republican president or presidential candidate has ever met with Confederate war veterans, and here is a man who himself fought in the Shenandoah Valley campaign hosting these veterans. They arrive at his home on North Market Street. He emerges from his house, and he reads a short set of remarks. Now, I've read a lot of his speeches from that fall. He gives 700 speeches. And this one is clearly written by him because it's short and it's deeply personal. He says sectionalism was surrendered at Appomattox. Not the South, but sectionalism. And he says, if we ever have to fight again, and God forbid that we have to, we shall fight as brothers under a common flag. And these Confederate war veterans are weeping at the sight of this Union war veteran saying, we're all in this together. And they line up and make their way across the front porch, shaking his hand, and then go back to the tabernacle for dinner. And then the Confederate band holds a concert until midnight. They hold a concert in the courthouse square. And then at midnight, they're conveyed by the people of Canton, Ohio, to the train station and get on their trains to return to Virginia. And I did read the accounts of this nationwide. I mean, this is like a moment of national reconciliation. It is why McKinley becomes the first presidential candidate in a quarter of a century to win an absolute majority of the electorate. The last guy to do it was Ulysses S. Grant in his 1872 reelection. And here is McKinley wiping out the Democrats in this election in large measure because he's been the unifying candidate. So, yeah, there's a message in there, and I hope they get it.
Anybody else?
Yeah, Phil. How are you, man?
Great. Thank you for being here today. It was wonderful work. How many bird hunts did you have to give up? How long, tell us from start to finish, how long did this
happen? Well, I actually sort of stumbled into this subject about 20 years ago, but I spent the last 3 years writing. I have 18 bins of archival material, and it wasn't the bird hunts that was so bad, but don't get Karen talking about all the other things I gave up. But I wrote this thing everywhere. I was writing it in the backs of taxi cabs and on airplanes and in weird hotels and everywhere, and I have 18 bins of archival material from a dozen libraries. I must admit that I really enjoyed visiting Charles G. Dawes' archives at Northwestern, which nobody had ever gone really through, because I had a really attractive research assistant who went with me, and she did a hell of a job of working the Xerox machine at the Northwestern Library, my wife Karen. But look, the more I got into it, the more fun it got, because there's a wild cast of characters. I'll just tell you one quick story and let you go. One of my favorite characters, and again, he's a minor figure, is Daniel E. Sickles. First of all, he was a Democrat general in the Civil War, and he was dreadful. He was one of these Democrat generals whom Lincoln couldn't afford to fire, but he's dreadful. He's the guy who, on the second day of Gettysburg, takes his entire corps off of Missionary Ridge and plunges them into Devil's Den and the Peach Orchard. Those of you who are Civil War buffs know what happened there. The entire Union corps is shot to pieces. Sickles himself loses a leg that day. One of his subordinates said the loss of his leg was a gain to us regardless of what it was to him. But he's been a lifelong Democrat. He's elected to the New York General Assembly in the early 1850s and immediately causes controversy by taking a well-known prostitute onto the floor of the New York General Assembly where she saw several of her clients. He then gets elected to Congress and goes to Washington, and he's a rake, and he's in his early 30s, and he's cutting a wide swath in Washington. And some of his colleagues say to him, Daniel, you got to cut this out. You got to get married. You're ruining your reputation. You're not going to be able to rise in politics. This is going to come back and bite you. So he gets married to a 16-year-old. Now, apparently, from all of the reports, I mean, the way that they describe her, she must have been stunning. She must have been unbelievably beautiful, but this doesn't keep him from straying. He continues to cat around, and she finds out about it. So she takes a lover in retaliation. He finds out about it, finds out where they're having an assignation, and breaks in on them in the middle of the act and proceeds to shoot her lover, Barton Key, son of Francis Scott Key, dead. He is the U.S. attorney for the District of Columbia. And Congressman Sickles gets off of the charge of murder by the first successful use of the defense of temporary insanity in the United States. And in 1896, he joins the Heroic Battalion Tour, which quickly gets dubbed the General's Tour. 40 Northern veterans, Union veterans, who get on the train of the governor of Michigan, Russell Alger, who's a cavalryman under George Armstrong Custer at Gettysburg, and they travel to the North to encourage Union veterans to turn out for what will be the last Civil War veteran to be elected president. And Daniel Sickles is funny as hell. He gets up in front of 13,000 people in Chicago. He says, "I wish I could kick William Jennings Bryan in the ass, but I only have one leg." And 13,000 people stood up cheering, pantomiming, kicking Bryan in the ass. He goes with O.O. Howard, the Christian general, to Kansas. O.O. Howard had lost one of his arms. And they go to a little town, Hutchinson, Kansas, where I recently spoke. And in Hutchinson, Kansas, in order to show that Hutchinson is a big place, they have identified a girl from each state from which settlers of Hutchinson have come. And Howard was born in New Hampshire and lives in Vermont. And Sickles says that, there was no New Yorker there. So he said, O.O. needed some help giving courtesies to the young girls, but he only had one arm, so I was happy to help him join in hugging them. And he's up there anyway. But here's this guy campaigning for McKinley, and the whole cat. I mean, every time you turn a page in the story of this election, there's one weird character after another, just like it. Anyway, let me tell you one other quick thing. Texas plays a role. We're a reliably Democratic state, but the Texas Republican Convention is held in what is now the Austin Club in Austin. You've been there, Chancellor Sharp. It was then the Millett Opera House. And the Combine, the bad guys, are led by the Republican National Committee man. For 25 years, the Republican National Committee man, the leader of the Republican Party of Texas, has been the well-educated, affluent, well-spoken black man from Galveston, Texas, Norris Wright Cuny. And the Combine men get together for a session on Sunday night, and they're concerned because of the 800 and some odd delegates to the Republican State Convention. 600 of them are black, 200 and some odd of them are white, and most of them are from McKinley. And the Combine men have to come up with a strategy to defeat them. And they can't come up with a good idea. In fact, they're broken up among themselves. So finally, at 1 o'clock in the morning, Cuny says, "I've had enough of this. I got an idea. Follow my lead." And he goes to all the black delegates and says, "I don't care who you're for president, but they're trying to keep the black man down. They're running a Jew from Houston for temporary chairman of the convention because they don't want me, a black man, to be the temporary chairman. So I don't care who you're for president, but elect me temporary chairman." So on Monday, they elect Norris Wright Cuny chairman. In the middle of the voting, Judge Rosenthal says, "I'm losing. I want to withdraw my name." A black delegate says, "We don't want him to withdraw. We want to beat him." And they do. Cuny becomes temporary chairman, appoints Bill Gooseneck McDonald from Forney, Texas, as the credentials chairman, and tosses out 200 of the McKinley men. They wipe out the Dallas delegation. They throw out the Bexar County delegation. The Travis County men are told, "You each have half a vote," and they give the other half of the vote to a Combine man. They send for free railroad passes, and they run in ringers. They delay the convention a day to give their new delegates a chance to arrive. And when the convention starts on Wednesday, Cuny realizes he's not stolen enough votes. He doesn't have. He can't call a single roll call because if he does, he will lose. So what does he do? Let me find it here. This is one of the better written parts of the book. I want to give it real justice here. Two 19, of course. How could I forget? Actually, earlier. Sorry. You'd think I'd be more familiar with this book by now. Maybe I should have had the same intern that Fred did.
Hey. Be nice.
Oh, 168. When it was time to pick four at-large delegates and four alternates, The hall, quote, had resolved itself into a troop of shouting, surging dervishes, end quote. CUNY ignored demands for a roll call. Instead, he shouted for a voice vote and immediately declared the combine slate the winners, though the McKinley men still outnumbered CUNY's followers. The hall exploded. The McKinley men stormed the stage, aiming to push CUNY aside and install Webb Flanagan, the GOP's 1890 gubernatorial candidate, in his place. Quote, one burly Negro came plowing through the jam, an Associated Press reporter wrote, pushing men in front of him as if they were so much chafe. Behind him was a determined, fast-moving mob of 500 angry McKinley men. CUNY expected the assault. His people were prepared to defend the podium and him. Quote, the first Negro to reach the stand made a lunge at CUNY's head with a fist, an eyewitness wrote. But little Bill Ellis, CUNY's longtime right-hand man, moved faster, pulling his revolver and shoving it in the assailant's face. Quote, the two men eyed each other for about 10 seconds, said a reporter, then grappled and went down with, quote, the howling mob swaying about and around and about them. A large table on the stage collapsed under the combatants. Delegates grabbed broken pieces as weapons. Chairs and other tables were smashed over heads or against bodies. Fists, bludgeons, bottles, knives, and razors appeared. Other pistols were drawn, but luckily not used. The fight went on for 20 minutes before the city marshal and a squad of officers arrived and began indiscriminately clubbing delegates. Of the 900 delegates to the Republican National Convention, 230 of them are challenged, led by all 30 delegates from Texas, are challenged in the credentials because it all ended in a fistfight in the Millet Opera House in Austin, Texas. Thanks for having me.
Carl, thank you so much for being with us. A little token. In appreciation for your visit and Karen's as well. We appreciate it having you here.
Thank you, Brad. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Afterwards, we will have a reception out in the foyer, and Carl will also be personalizing some of the books that you have purchased. He's got to make a couple of little video things first, but after that, he'll be back out. Secondly, if you'll please once again acknowledge the reason we're here, the President of the United States and Mrs. Clinton.